Rob Vischer. Welcome to my new storytelling podcast, God Out Loud. With every new episode, you'll hear thought-provoking stories of people who claim they heard God. Today, you'll hear from Ed Cash. Ed was making fun of Chris Tomlin's demo tape. Then God spoke up. If you want to hear more God Out Loud stories, follow God Out Loud on your favorite podcast app.
My first memories are being in the bathtub with my dad sitting on the john playing his electric guitar. He'd be playing these old 50s rock and roll songs, and I'd be splashing in the water, just dancing to the rhythm. He'd be tapping his foot on that tile bathroom floor. I can still hear it now.
This is Ed Cash. You might know his name, you might not. And by the way, not related to Johnny. I asked. But he is a musician, and you may have heard his music. Let's go way back.
I was in a band in high school. I was in a few bands and just dove in. Music just became my life. I was a hardcore athlete, and I gave up a lot of that just to pursue music because it was my greatest passion.
Ed gave up sports to go all in on music, but that wasn't all he gave up.
I got involved, you know, in a particular band and with some guys, and as I was wrestling with a lot of things internally, you know, I was a Christian. I had a conversion experience even as a young kid, but the older I grew, I just had some issues I was working through in my own heart with understanding grace and just feeling this pressure that I had to be perfect. And at a point, I just remember thinking, I can't do this anymore. And I started to run so hard from God. I mean, I really did. I just turned my head and was like, gave him the stiff arm and was like, that's it.
When I first heard Ed say this, my PKDAR went up. Pastor's Kid Radar. It's like reading the script for a faith-based blockbuster. He felt a need to be perfect. He abandoned faith. He joined a rock band. Watch the typical PK this summer. Ed was not a pastor's kid, but his dad was a CEO slash leader in the Charlotte, North Carolina business community. And for 17 years, Ed's dad served on the board of Young Life, a national ministry that disciples high school students. So I can see why a kid like Ed could feel overwhelmed with pressure. Back to Ed giving God the stiff arm.
Consequently, I got very involved with a lot of things I thought I would never do in my life, drugs, alcohol, and it became a very broken, sad existence to the point that I didn't even want to live. And I became obsessed with like even suicidal thoughts, but I was so scared of what the ultimate consequences of that would be. So I felt just trapped in this place of I don't want to live, but I don't want to die. And it was miserable. I went through 5 drug treatment centers, in and out of jail a couple times for dealing drugs to support my habit. And it was awful.
Ed slowly realized his addictions might destroy him. And he tried everything to break free. Finally, he joined Alcoholics Anonymous and got sober for 2 years. Alcoholics Anonymous is a 12-step program to help get out of alcoholism. But 6 out of 12 steps highlight a necessity to believe in God, starting with steps number 2 and number 3. For example, step number 2. And keep in mind, for some reason, every step is stated as if it's in the past tense. All right, step number 2. Came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. Step number 3, made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God as we understood him. Although Ed had taken both of those steps, as well as the other 10, he still wanted to understand more about who God is.
I was in AA and I had a sponsor up there. And he talked about this silent retreat that some men did every year. And it was at this Jesuit retreat place up in Minnesota, outside St. Cloud. And I'd never heard of the Jesuits or any of that stuff. And I'm not Catholic, Jesuit, or any of that. But I wanted to be open to how God might be wanting to speak to me. And I understand at this time, I had run so far from God that if you'd asked me if I believed in Christ at that time, I would have said, I don't know. at this Jesuit retreat place, it was basically silent the whole time. You'd eat meals and you'd hear forks clanking and just the sound of men breathing and chewing their food. But there was something about it. I feel like I had given my own heart enough margin to just be still enough to hear God. And I remember being underneath this tree that had heart leaves on it. And I'd taken one of the heart leaves off. I picked it. And then I walked back to my room and I was journaling. And I feel myself even getting emotional thinking about it because God, I mean, Jesus showed up in that room so real. And it was just like me and him. And I just sensed his presence in a profound way. And I knew that he was real. It was like, yeah, he's the same Jesus of my childhood, but he's different. And what I mean by that is he didn't change, but my perspective of him changed. Some of the wounds and the baggage that I'd had around his name and church and all that stuff started to fall, and the healing process began.
Even though Ed started to believe in God at Alcoholics Anonymous, and now in Jesus through the silent retreat, he still didn't necessarily believe in church.
I became very jaded toward the church. And I associated church as a place that you have to go and you better look good, you better sound good, you better smell good, the whole thing. I mean, all of the senses, like church is the one place you would never want to get vulnerable.
In Alcoholics Anonymous, Ed confessed his deepest secrets and sins. In church, Ed felt like he needed to put on a show. And Ed was done putting on a show in every area of his life, even music.
So when I was into drugs, alcohol, that's when I really started getting into music and bands and stuff. So when I got clean, man, I put my guitar down for 2 years and I was like, I literally did not touch it. And I thought I would never touch it again because I was so convinced that music was the thing that had led me down these dark paths.
Slowly, Ed got back into music, but it wasn't because God spoke to him.
I remember seeing James Taylor when I was, probably about 23 years old. And I got so emotional, I was just weeping watching him. And I remember thinking, if I could ever bring half that much joy to people through music, that to me would be the dream.
So Ed started touring and eventually met a Christian recording artist named Bebo Norman. Weird name, right? They became friends and Ed produced a couple of his albums.
We were like best friends at the time. We're, you know, living together. When you get to work with an artist like Bebo, man, he is just so good. You know, his songs are incredible. When you get to work on something like that, that becomes in a lot of ways your calling card. People hear that and they think, wow, what happened with that? I got to receive a lot of the credit on the recording side just because Bebo has an amazing voice and he's an amazing songwriter. So it was a win for me in a huge way. I feel like that record just led to a lot of other records coming my way.
Ed largely credits Bebo's talent and Bebo's songwriting for his own success. But if you hear from others in the Christian music industry during the late 90s, they tell a slightly different story.
Ed's amazing, a great producer, sweetheart of a guy, just like Bebo, just the sweetest guy you've ever met in your life. Him and Bebo, I think, made the whole record because Ed plays everything.
Meet Derek Webb, an early member of the hit Christian band Cademan's Call. Cademan's Call discovered and signed Ed's friend Bebo Norman to their label. Derek is an award-winning songwriter who has made a full-time living in music for 25 years. And listen to how Derek describes Ed's level of talent.
The thing about a guy like Ed is he plays every instrument all your bandmates play, but better than all of them. So it's really hard being 10 times the drummer, 10 times the singer, 10 times the guitar player, 10 times the keyboard player, 10 times the bass player, than everybody who you're working with, but having to patiently let them get their performances out when you know you could grab their instruments and do 10 times the job.
To put it more bluntly,
he was amazing. He's just a freak talent.
Right before Ed started getting noticed by people like Derek, Ed met a girl.
I was at that time a touring artist, and I would go and see her, and we dated long distance for about 7 months. So when we ended up getting married, we lived in Charlotte, and we started having kids pretty much right away. But when she was pregnant with our third kid, we just really felt like for us, we wanted to sort of step out and create our own life. I mean, Charlotte is all I'd ever known. And we really just felt like for the health of our marriage, it was important that we step away and establish our own roots.
So they started looking for a new hometown.
We were going to move to Chattanooga, And then last minute, we were like, what if we went to Nashville? I mean, there's music there. So we actually got the opportunity to come here and stay in a corporate apartment for about maybe a month and a half working on a Cademan's Call record.
In contemporary Christian music in the 90s and early 2000s, Cademan's Call hit the college circuit as a folk rock band with acoustic singer-songwriter sensibilities. During that time, for better or worse, Christian pop culture was blowing up. Think WWJD bracelets as fashion, VeggieTales in Walmart, and Christian bookstores in every shopping mall. Oh, and my favorite, Christian boy bands. In that rise of Christian pop culture, college students and young adults were looking for a brand of music that sounded more honest and organic than most Christian radio at the time. After having some massive yet very unexpected Christian radio success, Cademan's Call discovered and signed Bebo Norman to their own record label and took him on tour.
He got on tour with Cademan's because they heard about him, really liked his stuff. And yeah, so we came here and got to spend a month and a half here recording in downtown Franklin. And just being in Franklin and around Nashville was what sealed the deal for us. We're like, this place could actually be pretty cool.
Ed and his family moved from Charlotte, North Carolina to just south of Nashville, Franklin, Tennessee. And after producing records for Bebo and Cademan's, producing Christian-leaning singer-songwriters became his trademark. I'll let Derek Webb explain.
There were all these people coming out of kind of the indie scene, basically like singer-songwriters, dudes who play acoustic guitar and sing songs. He figured out a way to make each one of those artists sound unique and figure out what it was that those artists each liked and do that for them. He was the guy who was kind of raising the tide under that indie community because the records that were coming out of it were excellent and sounded radio ready. And nobody knew another guy who knew how to do that. He just knew how to do it. He just knew how to make the record sound amazing.
Bebo played at a Young Life camp, and one summer when he was there, he had a guy play drums with him whose name was Dave Barnes. Then Dave introduced me to his friend Matt Wirtz. So I did records for both of those guys. And then I did a record for Matt called 23 Places. Brad O'Donnell got a hold of Matt Wirtz, 23 Places. Brad and I were just figuring this thing out. You know, he's a new A&R guy, I'm a new producer. And he said he'd heard this Matt Wirtz record. And he said, man, we got this guy. He's kind of like a up and coming worship leader. And this is, I guess, 2004. He said, man, I'd love it if you'd meet with him. And we met and I liked him, but I was just like, gosh, I don't know if I want to get involved with worship music.
Ed's experience with drugs, alcohol, and addiction left him very skeptical and wounded by two things, church and music. So when his friend Brad asked him to work on a worship album with a new worship leader, Ed just heard church music.
Because church did not feel like a safe place for me, anything that was associated with church started feeling unsafe. So church music felt unsafe to me because I didn't understand it. The church we first went to was First Presbyterian Charlotte. Now, I didn't really know the pastor, and I'm not in any way knocking the hearts of those people. But from my perspective, what I saw was all these fancy robes, this high church pipe organ, you know, everybody in their Sunday best. I felt like it was a performance in the very place that I wished that I'd felt welcomed in my brokenness. So to me, it brought a lot of the associations of just, ooh, stay away from church music.
Even though Ed wasn't really a big fan of church music, Brad, the A&R guy, was one of his best friends. So when Brad's new worship artist sent Ed his demo, Ed listened.
So anyway, he sends me a cassette tape. This is before iPhones. He sends me a cassette tape. You see that desk right there? On top of that, I had a little jam box on the right side, and I popped it in. So I'm sitting at that desk in the chair. Oh, this is crazy. I've never told this story while looking at that desk. I'm getting emotional. So anyway, I'm sitting there and I start listening to these songs, and it's just him and his acoustic guitar, like in his kitchen or something. And all of a sudden, the beginning stages of that song come on. Man, I'm telling you, like I literally started laughing out loud, making fun of it. And I was like, I cannot work with this guy. Like this is everything I can't stand about worship music. He's just saying the same thing over and over again, four chords, just keep saying the same. I'm like, what is that? It felt like How Great Thou Art, just a new version of it or something. And man, as sure as we are sitting here, I felt the Holy Spirit of God. I've never heard the audible voice of God, but this is about as audible as it's ever been for me. I felt God say to me, how dare you curse what I have kissed?
Quick recap. Ed heard God. God told Ed,
how dare you curse what I have kissed?
Which means God had kissed these worship songs. Now, Ed believed God was the God of the universe, and he had kissed these songs. But even though Ed claims he heard God, in his pride, he still wasn't totally convinced God's kiss meant that this worship album was cool enough. So he asked his wife.
She said, I really think you need to pray about working with this guy. I just have a sense about it. My church experience with my wife before that was that she's got her hands in the air. You know, she's tearing up, getting completely lost in the spirit of worship. And I'm like over there with my arms crossed, looking at the whole thing, just thinking, yeah, I cannot get into this.
So Ed heard from God. Then he heard from his wife. But he was still hesitant to take on the project.
I was about to pass on it, but I also was terrified of letting Brad down. He was my new guy, and he's like A&R, and I'm like, here's my break. It's a worship artist. I'm like, oh my gosh, Lord, what are you doing?
Ed felt torn between his cool and God's kiss. So he sat down and listened to more of the tape. He heard a song on it called Unfailing Love, and it moved him deeply.
I mean, that honestly was the moment for me. I was like, I want in. So I told Brad, I was like, let's go, let's do it. And then I remember we had a song meeting and we were just going through songs. He played How Great. And at that time, you know, How Great didn't have a bridge to it. And I remember him getting to the end of the second chorus and that was the end of the song. Man, when you start speaking into people's songs, you got to be really careful because in some way, it could be like calling their baby ugly. It's a sensitive thing. I said, I just wonder if it needs another place to go there, like a response to all that you've just said. He's like, well, like what? And man, I just picked up a guitar and literally, I wasn't even thinking about it. And I just started singing that, you know, name above all names.
How Great Is Our God was released by Chris Tomlin in 2004. According to the authoritative songselect.ccli.com, it's still one of the top 20 most sung worship songs in churches around the nation every week, 17 years after it was released. And for a list of Chris's accomplishments, let's go to his official bio. To read it, here's Christian radio veteran and Houston's KSBJ afternoon co-host, Carlos.
Chris Tomlin has sold millions of albums, streamed billions of tracks, spawned 16 number one radio singles, and been awarded with multiple RIAA gold and platinum certifications, and a list of Grammy, Dove, Billboard Music, and American Music Awards. Touted by Time Magazine as the most often sung artist anywhere. On any given Sunday, tens of millions of people in churches across the globe sing songs from Chris's rich worship-focused catalog.
In other words, Chris Tomlin might be the most successful songwriter in the world. Not the most successful Christian songwriter, just most successful songwriter. And according to AllMusic.com, Ed Cash has produced at least 8 of his albums. Ed never saw this coming. When he heard Chris's demo, remember his response?
I literally started laughing out loud, making fun of it. And I was like, I cannot work with this guy. Like this is everything I can't stand about worship music.
That was Ed then. This is Ed now.
God, in his infinite goodness, I think was setting me up in that moment to change the trajectory of my life. First off, the fact that he took a phrase like name above all name is not the most creative lyric. And he sort of opened the heavens for this moment for me to pull me in to say, I want you to be a part of this. Being a part of that song has been one of the great honors of my life, but I really don't feel like I even did anything. I mean, seriously, I was just kind of like there.
Ed and his family have enjoyed the financial and creative benefits of Chris Tomlin's success. But it's clear that there's something he values way more.
It has taught me how to be a worshiper, not just through music, but in my life, how to see and appreciate God. Like I'm looking out our window right now and there's rain coming down and I see these trees. That causes me to worship. I think the influence on my children has been profound, teaching them to be worshipers, teaching them how to engage the Spirit of God on their own, how to come into His presence and what it means to honor Him, not just with their singing, but with their lives. I've seen the effects of that.
Ed's family is obviously important to him. He and his wife moved from Charlotte to Nashville for the health of their marriage. He quit touring and became a producer so that he could spend more time with his wife and kids. And now he's started touring again with his multi-generational family worship band, We the Kingdom. His daughter Franny is the lead singer. His son Martin is the drummer. His brother Scott and one of his best friends, Andrew Berchtold, are the do-it-all multi-instrumentalists. When they started the band, one of their dreams was to play Red Rocks, one of the most beautiful and iconic music venues in Colorado.
So that winter in January, I wish I had the video right now to play it for you, but my son Martin and I and our whole family, Franny, we went to Red Rocks just to see it, and it was snowing like crazy. It was a blizzard, covered in snow, and we had just started We the Kingdom, you know, maybe a few months before, and Martin took his iPhone and sort of scanned it around where snow's blowing in our faces. We got, you know, toboggans on and all that. He goes, "We the Kingdom, baby!" Just kind of like dreaming, like maybe someday, 10 years, whatever.
It didn't take 10 years. We the Kingdom played Red Rocks for their first show. And guess who they opened for? Chris Tomlin. And the story gets crazier, even a little mystical, when they soundchecked with their new song, Holy Water.
We started playing Holy Water at Red Rocks during soundcheck. It started raining like crazy just for that song and stopped right when we got done with Holy Water. It was so epic. I can't even, there were a lot of witnesses, so I'm not lying, but it was bizarre.
Even more bizarre, Holy Water became their first Christian radio smash hit, and it's fueled much of their success. On their first album, titled Holy Water, they had 2 number ones, 4 top tens, and they won the Dove Awards for Album of the Year and Contemporary Christian Artist of the Year. Now, some Christian music fans online have knocked their hit song Holy Water for being too superstitious or ritualistic. But as I interviewed Ed, it seemed clear that his vision of Holy Water was not about religious ritual or superstition. For Ed, Holy Water looks more like this.
My first memories are being in the bathtub with my dad sitting on the John playing his electric guitar. He'd be playing these old 50s rock and roll songs, and I'd be splashing in the water, just dancing to the rhythm.
Ed's life seems pretty great now. He's a famous producer, he has a big house, and his family worship band is a huge national success. But remember, he was hurt by the church. He gave God the stiff arm. He dealt drugs. He went to jail. He became cynical and jaded, and he didn't even want to do worship music. If you asked Ed his secret, his success hasn't been about pulling himself up by the bootstraps and making his dreams a reality. He succeeded when he's chosen to splash in the water and dance to the rhythm of his father's music.
I could go on and on about the transformation in my life that's happened just by saying yes to God when I didn't really want to at first.
Thanks for listening. If you like this story, hit follow or subscribe now. Also, you can help me tell more stories by going to godoutloud.com and funding more stories like this one. And if you have a true story you want to share with me, go to godoutloud.com and say, "Yo, Rob, I have a story." The theme song is written by me and produced by the 6'5 giant, Joe Fry. And thanks to Ed Cash, Derek Webb, and Carlos from KSBJ. You can find We the Kingdom's music at wethekingdom.com. And go see them live. You'll be glad you did. Help me tell more stories of people who claim they heard God by going to godoutloud.com now and funding more God Out Loud stories. Because I'm not selling a self-help book, I can't promise your life will get better instantly. But I can promise you'll get some cool gear and all the profit will go toward the Create More Stories Fund and the Feed My Family Fund. Thank you for your generosity. On December 29, 2020, Ed's dad passed away. Here's an excerpt from his obituary. He loved music and began playing guitar at age 15. Some of the family's favorite memories are watching him play around the house and playing on stages with him. Even until his last days, the mention of Chuck Berry and Johnny B. Goode would instinctively cause him to start playing air guitar.
My dad's name is Francis. And so Franny is named after my dad. So, and just seeing his love for music and all that sort of carry through. There's a picture of her walking off the stage at Red Rocks. There's 10,000 people behind her. It's like she just went to Disney World for the first time, just the joy on her face. But it's been, man, a blessing beyond measure just to see how God has continued to really to use music as a gift to share with people, but also just to keep us in love with him.